If you're interested in taking creatine to boost your performance or your cognition, then this video is for you. I'm going to cover who should consider taking it, what dose you should take, what type you should take, along with a few other common queries and bits to consider. If you're new here, I'm Maria and I'm a registered dietitian. Welcome to the channel. Now, before I get stuck in, please don't watch this video and think that you need to go straight to the checkout to buy creatine. You really don't, and you will be perfectly healthy without it. I have never taken it and I would consider it as a nice to have in terms of its benefits for exercise performance. And yes, there are now benefits beyond this, such as mood, cognitive function, and memory. But nailing the basics of a well-balanced diet can be hard enough for many of us. We don't need to complicate it any further, unless we really want to. In simple terms, creatine is an energy source for the body. We eat it through our food, particularly meat, and we produce it naturally in our bodies. Emphasis on naturally here. It's not a steroid or anything like that. And the goal of taking a creatine supplement is to get your creatine stores as close to 100% saturation as possible. For most people who eat a diet that includes meat, creatine stores sit at around 60 to 80% full, and vegetarians and vegans sit at stores of around 55 to 60%. And supplementing with creatine can increase the stores of creatine in our body by up to 40%. As I said, creatine is found in food. It's found in meat, fish, and dairy. However, the amount of creatine in food isn't as much as you would think. To put this into perspective, one of the best sources of creatine is red meat. But you would need to eat 1.3 kg of beef to get the same amount of creatine as one scoop of powder. And creatine supplements are amongst the most popular and widely researched supplements. So unlike many other supplements, they're not just a load of marketing hype. They have been around a very long time and there has been a lot of research conducted using them. Now I'm going to pause here and ask that if you're enjoying the video so far, I would really appreciate it if you hit the red subscribe button below. It really helps support my channel so I can continue making more videos like this one. And while you're at it, I would love it if you gave the video a thumbs up too. So as I said, creatine is an energy source for the body as it helps make ATP. Now ATP provides immediate and short bursts of energy. So it's useful for explosive movements like sprinting or powerlifting or a serve in tennis. But the body does not store much ATP. And when it's depleted, it takes a long time for it to build back up again. But having good stores of creatine is like a shortcut that boosts ATP without that waiting around lag time. So to clear up a major misconception about creatine itself does not make you more muscular. Instead, it helps provide your muscles with the energy to do more work, which can then translate to being able to lift that little bit heavier and get in that extra set in the gym that you may not have otherwise been able to do. And there is a lot of evidence to support creatine being able to do this. The first scenario to consider creatine is if you want to enhance your exercise performance. So there is good evidence for creatine supplementation if you are looking to increase your muscle mass and strength, if you want to improve performance during high intensity exercise, particularly ones that have single outburst movements that are less than 30 seconds in duration. So again, like a heavy powerlift or a sprint or a serve in tennis. There are also recovery benefits, useful for if you're training for a marathon, for example. Creatine can reduce muscle damage and encourage greater replenishment of glycogen stores than carbohydrates alone, which is beneficial for endurance athletes. But when it comes to sports nutrition, you need to have the basics right first, like eating enough to fuel your workouts in general, eating enough protein and training efficiently, having enough rest and so on. Now, if you're new to the gym or maybe you've been working out for a while, but you still find it hard to be consistent with the basics, then I wouldn't be adding this additional layer on top. I like to tell my clients to think of a performance enhancing supplement like baking a cake. First, you need all the basic ingredients for the cake. You need to get that cake into the oven and it needs to come out okay. And if it does, then you can consider adding icing on top. But if you don't have the basics right, that cake becomes a floppy mess and you're just wasting your time trying to put icing on a collapsed cake. Now, there are other reasons beyond exercise performance where you could consider creatine. And one of these is for mental health and mood. Since creatine plays a role in energy metabolism, there seems to be a connection with creatine and how well the brain is firing. And the research does now show an established relationship between mood and the presence of adequate creatine in the brain. Beyond mood, creatine may be beneficial for our overall cognition and our mental performance. Supplementation may help reduce mental fatigue and support normal memory functions, especially when under stress, such as sleep deprivation, mild exercise, and even in stressful mathematical tasks, like doing your tax returns. You could also consider creatine around menopause. Menopause is a challenging time for women and their bodies. Estrogen levels are at an all-time low, making it more difficult for women to build or maintain muscle and to keep strong bones. And studies have found that whole body resistance training in combination with creatine supplementation in postmenopausal women helped to maintain healthy bone mass and increased strength. So creatine is a viable option here, but I would prioritize making sure that you're getting enough protein, calcium, and vitamin D, as well as the resistance training first. Then creatine could be your icing on the cake. Now, another area to consider creatine is with aging. With aging comes muscle loss. In fact, after the age of 30, we can start losing muscle mass. And as we get older, our bodies become less efficient at rebuilding protein. So honestly, protein powders and creatine have more of a place in nursing homes than they do in most gym locker rooms. These marginal gains are most beneficial to the older population. But again, it's icing on the cake. Eating enough, eating protein, and resistance exercise are the core building blocks as we age. Now I'm going to take this opportunity to emphasize how important resistance training is as we do get older. And I don't mean waiting until you're in your 70s. I mean starting now, and it will then benefit you as you age. I love running, and running is great for your cardiovascular health, but your muscle mass is so important for function as you get older. If you want to be able to carry your own shopping, get yourself up off your chair, in and out of the bed, building in small amounts of resistance training is needed to prioritize maintaining your muscle strength. Now, there is also emerging positive evidence behind the role of creatine in pregnant people. During pregnancy, creatine stores are reduced, and the fetus relies on the mother's creatine throughout most of the pregnancy. And it seems to play an important role in brain development. Animal studies are showing really promising results, but at this time, we don't have much evidence from human studies on pregnancy. However, there is a large one underway right now. And I am a specialized prenatal dietitian, so this is definitely a space I'll be keeping an eye on to help support my pregnant clients. So after all that, if you do decide to take creatine, how do you take it and what's the best type to take? Well, there are several different types of creatine. However, creatine monohydrate is proven to be the most affordable and effective form of creatine supplement. And you can generally find it in a variety of forms, whether that's a powder to mix with water or a pill or a gummy. I would say to choose whichever type suits you the best. But if you are using it in a powder, it's best to only mix it in with cold drinks, so not add it to teas or coffee. Now, I always recommend to choose supplements that have undergone third-party testing. Sadly, there is a lot of contamination in dietary supplements. So if you can, look for certifications like NSF for Sport, Informed Choice, or USP. So there are two ways to go about taking creatine. Number one is a loading phase followed by a maintenance daily dose. Number two is simply following that daily consistent dose. Doing the loading phase isn't necessary, but it makes reaching your peak creatine stores quicker. So for the loading phase, the recommendations are 0.3 grams of creatine per kg of body weight per day. Or to make it easier, you can just take 20 grams of creatine. But you want to divide it into around 4 daily doses and do this for around 5 to 7 days. Then after this, you go on to the maintenance phase, which is around 3 to 5 grams of creatine per day. Now, if you want, you can just skip the loading phase and just take 3 to 5 grams of creatine every day. Now, for larger athletes that are engaged in really intense exercise, they may need to consume even more, so around 5 to 10 grams of creatine each day. And this will help to maintain optimal capacity. So if you're a big, massive Irish rugby player, for example, and if you're worried that you're maybe going overboard or taking too much, the excess is excreted in your urine. Now, when is the best time to take it? You don't need to stress too much, but if you can, it's best to take it after exercise or with a carbohydrate-containing meal, as this will help it get sucked up into the muscle. So creatine has been around a while, and I think because of that, there does seem to be a few horror headlines or misconceptions about it. But creatine in itself is very safe. As I said, it's naturally produced in the body. And even if you oversupplement, the excess will be peed out in your urine. So it's not a supplement I would ever worry too much about. The dangers really are if you're buying a random one off the internet that isn't third-party tested. Now, will creatine cause me to gain weight or become bulky? And this is the most common concern for women who are considering taking creatine. But creatine does not increase your body fat. However, it is true that some people do experience a small amount of weight gain when they do start taking creatine. But this is related to a temporary increase in body water. And creatine does, in fact, increase your cellular hydration. But this is considered a positive side effect because you are better hydrated as a result. Now, I hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, I'm sure you'll enjoy my video about how much protein you should be taking, which I'll leave linked here. And as a thank you for making it all the way to the end of the video, I want to let you know that I have a free recipe ebook, which I've linked in the description box below. Thank you very much for watching. Stay happy and healthy, and I'll see you again next week.